Myself and Dr. Chandrika Ponnamperuma, cardiologist, will discuss the case. A bleeding and chest pain in a patient with a mechanical heart valve. This 53-year-old male patient and admitted to National Hospital Kandy on 2nd February 2021 around 11 a.m. with a history of hematuria for 2 days and chest pain and shortness of breath for 1 day duration. So he gives a history of mitral valve replacement in 2011 and also it for the tight mitral stenosis. Also had permanent atrial fibrillation, ischemic stroke in 2009 and warfarin induced upper GI bleeding and anterior non-STEMI in 2019 and heart failure with preserved ejection fraction as well. His hematuria was painless. There were 2 episodes over these 2 days. There were no other urinary symptoms on admission. The hematuria was settled and the urine was... No other bleeding manifestations. Not taken the previous day of warfarin dose. He had been having symptoms of NYHA grade 3 to 4 heart failure symptoms for the last 1 month. On top of that, he has developed ischemic type of chest pain and shortness of breath for 1 day duration. He has not checked his INR for the last 3 months. From the hospital. Before that, INR has been the normal therapeutic range. According to the clinic notes, his hemoglobin was 10 to 10.5 gram per deciliter. And he was on hematonics, as the blood picture shows mixed deficiency anemia. He has defaulted investigations to exclude inducible ischemia following his MI in 2019. He was on warfarin 6 mg, enterocorticoid aspirin 75 mg, visoprolol 5 mg, atorvastatin 40 mg, omeprazole and hematonics. The drug compliance was satisfactory. He used to take green leaves according to the instructions given. He has not been on any other medications. On examination, there was mild pallor with bilateral mild leg edema. The pulse rate was 86 and he was in atrial fibrillation. The blood pressure was normal. Metallic heart sounds were well heard and there were no regurgitant murmurs. Respiratory rate was 26 per minute. The saturation was 94%. There were crepitations in both lung fields, mid and lower zones. The bedside urine sample was clear. The ECG showed atrial fibrillation with the T inversions V1 to V6. The blood was taken for urgent INR, full blood count, UFR, and the troponin, and also the basic investigations. The troponin was positive with the 1.988 nanogram per deciliter. The history, ischemic type chest pain, ECG changes, and the positive troponin, we made the diagnosis of anterior non-STEMI with acute and chronic heart failure. So discussed with the cardiologist team as well, the clopidogrel 300 mg loading dose was given followed by 75 mg. Considering his the thrombotic risk and also unavailability of the INR at that moment, we gave the enoxaparin 40 mg stat dose as well. Continued aspirin 75 mg without giving a loading dose. Rosuvimide IV infusion was started. The brisparol was withheld as he was in acute heart failure. Oral digoxin was started to control the heart rate. We got down his investigation. The hemoglobin was low, 9.5 gram per deciliter. The INR was high, 5.67, and the UFR shows RBC 100 to 150. Other basic investigations were normal. 2D echo showed ejection fraction 35 to 40% with the anterior wall hypokinesia, and the mitral valve processes was well functioning. And there were no paravalvular regurgitation or leaks, no thrombiovegetations. Warfarin withheld with the high INR. However, on day 2, he restarted bleeding again with the fresh blood in urine. The clopidogrel and low molecular weight heparin 2 withheld. Aspirin 75 mg was continued. INR was still high, 5.21. The hemoglobin was a little lower than the previous 8 gram per deciliter. So because of that, we have transfused him with a packed cell RBC slowly under furosemide cover. The aspirin, statin and digoxin, omeprazole and furosemide were continued. That irrigation was done with the advice by the GU surgeon. Plan was to arrange cystoscopy once the patient was stable. The cardiology opinion was taken at this moment and started conventional heparin, and the aspirin, furosemide, and digoxin continued. Sorry, I think I have missed one. So day four, patient developed an ischemic chest pain again with features of heart failure. ECG showed tachycardia with atrial fibrillation and key inversion in V1 to V6. Troponin high sensitivity was elevated, 500 nanogram per liter. INR was high, 4.25. Hemoglobin was still low, 9 gram per deciliter. No active bleeding. So at this moment that we started conventional heparin with the discussion of the cardiologist. Aspirin, furosemide, and digoxin were continued. Few hours later, heart failure worsened. Monitor showed non-sustained VT, and which confirmed by the ECG. Treated with an amiodarone bolus followed by an infusion. 1 hour later, he went into the cardiogenic shock and we started iron probes and wrist pressures. He developed a cardiac arrest with a pulseless VT around 6 p.m. the same day. Resuscitated and maximum supportive care continued with monitoring. However, the next morning, around 5 a.m., he developed another cardiac arrest and we could not resuscitate him. So this is a patient with very high thrombotic risk in the presence of mechanical heart valves, atrial fibrillation, heart failure, the previous history of cardiovascular diseases, MI and the strokes, who was on warfarin, presented with a bleeding and thrombosis. He also had underlying chronic anemia, probably due to upper GI bleeding and also the poor compliance. So he had two main management problems. The management of bleeding in a patient with high thrombotic risk and management of acute coronary syndrome in the presence of bleeding. I will discuss the first part and Dr. Chandrika will discuss the second part. So management of bleeding in a patient with high thrombotic risk according to the guidelines. These are my references for this presentation. And this is very important picture actually, because this shows the how the bleeding will cause the thrombosis. With the major bleeding, there will be anticoagulant and antiplatelet discontinuation, which will lead to prothrombotic state leading to thrombosis. Again, they will go into shock and also the severe anemia. With the anemia, we need to transfuse that will lead to inflammation and oxidative stress causing plaque rupture and causing again thrombosis. And the shock will lead to myocardial ischemia. Again, will lead to the thrombosis, so it can cause the inflammation and oxidative stress again the same path there. So same thing has happened to our patient as well. When you get a patient with thrombosis and bleeding, you must assess the thrombotic risk versus the bleeding risk, as previously mentioned by the two other speakers. So let's see what is the thrombotic risk in our patients. In the presence of mechanical mitral valve, he carries a very high risk. On top of that, he has atrial fibrillation with a Chadwick score 4, carries a high risk. So obviously, he carries a very high risk of thrombosis. So his bleeding risk is, as it has played these three, because he has three risk factors, stroke, the bleeding history, and also the labile INR. So he is carrying a moderate to high risk of bleeding as well. So let's see what is the target INR in this our patient. The mechanical, in the presence of mechanical mitral valve, it has to be 3. But if they are having the risk factors like atrial fibrillation, heart failure with ejection fraction less than 35%, previous thromboembolism, LA spontaneous echo contrast, mitral stenosis, and LA size more than 50, it has to be 3.5. So in our patient, again, it has to be 3.5. So median INR value is recommended rather than a range, because in the extreme values in the range, either it's not safe or effective. Let's see how do we manage a patient with a high INR. If there's no bleeding or mild bleeding, in the presence of INR 4 to 6, either you can reduce the warfarin dose or stop it for 1 to 2 days. and we can restart the warfarin with a lower dose. First should be investigated. If the INR is 6 to 8, if the other risk factors for bleeding is there, you may give 1 milligram oral vitamin K. If the INR is more than 8, give 2 milligram of oral vitamin K. Again, when the INR is more than 10, remember all these are for the no bleeding or minimal bleeding. You have to give oral vitamin K 5 milligram. The course need to be identified on all these situations. Let's see what's the place of vitamin K for high INR in the presence of mechanical mitral valve. ACCHA does not recommend vitamin K in patients with mechanical heart valves, as vitamin K will induce hypercoagulable state, cause in thrombosis and thromboembolism. High dose of vitamin K also will increase the risk of warfarin resistance, and higher doses are needed to reach the high INR target. The guidelines recommend prothrombotic complex concentrate or PCC to manage bleeding on mechanical heart valve patients compared to high dose of vitamin K. However, low dose of vitamin K can still be considered with the PCC combination. Immediately reverse anticoagulation effect can only be done if there is major bleeding. So what are the causes of major bleeding? The intracranial, retroperitoneal, intraocular, pericardial, muscle bleed with compartment syndrome, or if there's any kind of active bleeding with hypotension or 2 gram per deciliter fall of hemoglobin, or leading to transfusion or 2 or more blood transfusions, again, it causes the major bleeding. In that situation, you have to stop warfarin, give vitamin K 10 milligram intravenously this time, give PCC. If PCC is not available, you have to give FFP and identify the cause. So in our patient, have we managed our patients according to the guidelines? Whether we would have given a small dose of vitamin K and PCC with his second bleed when the INR was still more than 5, and continue dual antiplatelets and conventional or heparin or arranged PCI. Let's see what the cardiologist want to say. Over to you, Chandika.
Thank you, Kimudini. I wish to thank the president, councils, and the academic committees of the Sri Lanka College of Internal Medicine and SLMA for giving me this opportunity. And in this sort of forum, it is usual to select a success story for presentation, though failures have more academic value. Dr. Kumudini Jaisingh has courage and selfless attitude towards academic advancement, demonstrated by selecting this case of a presentation demand a round of applause. Thank you very much, Kumudini, for that. So basically the topic is, which I have to discuss, is acute coronary syndrome and non-ST elevation MI in a bleeding patient with a mitral valve prosthesis and on warfarin. So bleeding and thrombosis are two inherently conflicting problems, actually two problems which can be life-threatening. And it's conflicting because treating one will aggravate the other. So when you are managing a patient with acute coronary syndrome, a bleeding patient, there are a few principles which I would stick to. First would be treat the more life-threatening entity more aggressively than the other. The second would be to avoid over-treating either, because both can be life-threatening. You have to use your judgment to decide to which extent to treat each of them. When you are managing the bleed, it's better to take local measures to stop the bleed early than aggressively correcting the coagulation defect whenever possible. For example, if it's a gastric bleed, try to get an endoscopy done and treat the ulcer locally. In this case, it was a urinary tract bleed, so you have to try to address that early. Then when correcting the hemostatic defect, what you should do is a calculated correction of the specific clotting factor defect in this case, it was due to warfarin, high INR. The best way to correct it is using prothrombin complex concentrate and a calculated amount to achieve a target INR rather than to overcorrect it. Then, when managing the acute coronary syndrome, one should stick to guideline-based minimum antithrombotic regime in managing it. And there's a definite place for early coronary angiography and PCI of the culprit vessel with the use of, again, minimum essential antithrombotic treatment whenever possible. So these are the six guidelines, which principles which I would stick to when managing a patient like this. Anyway, as cardiologists, we love guidelines, so we'll see later on what the guidelines would say about this. So from here on, I will be discussing with a patient whose acute coronary syndrome poses a greater risk to life than the bleed, as in this patient. So what we do will we give in the initial medical management? Aspirin. It's usual for us to give 300 milligrams of loading, followed by 75 to 100 milligrams daily in patients with acute coronary syndromes. However, if the INR is known to be more than 3, you should avoid giving the loading dose of 300, and you should give the maintenance dose of 75 to 100 only. In all other patients, including those on NOACs and those on warfarin with INR less than 3, the loading dose is indicated. Then the second antiplatelet agent we use is a P2Y12 inhibitor, and clopidogrel is the preferred agent in the presence of high bleeding risk. You should not use agents like pasugrel and ticagrelor. And now, anyway, even without high bleeding risk, patients who are having non-ST elevation myocardial infarctions, who have life-threatening features, who need to be taken to the cath lab early, what is recommended is not to load with clopidogrel. This doesn't, with P2Y12 inhibitors. This does not apply for patients who are being managed medically, who will not be taken to cath lab early, but people who are taken to cath lab early, it is suggested to avoid loading, because most of the time these severe non-ST elevation myocardial infarctions end up having non-stentable lesions, which need surgical revascularization, and loading with clopidogrel or P2Y12 inhibitors will delay the bypass surgery due to high bleeding risk. In any way, in this patient where the bleeding risk is also high, that it is more true than in others that you should avoid loading with clopidogrel. Then the anticoagulation. When you're using anticoagulation, the question is, should all these patients be giving anticoagulants like heparin or enoxaparin? Answer is no. Patients who are on warfarin for prosthetic valves, for DVT and pulmonary embolism should be continued on warfarin alone without switch to parenteral anticoagulation with heparin or enoxaparin, provided that they are within the therapeutic INR. But patients who are on warfarin or NOACs for atrial fibrillation should be started on parenteral anticoagulation either when the next NOAC dose is due, or for patients who are on warfarin when the INR is less than 2. Otherwise, you should not give anticoagulants. So out of the anticoagulants, unfractionated heparin is considered better in the setting of a recent bleed due to easy reversibility than low molecular weight heparins like enoxaparin. Then the other management like statins, beta blockers, nitrates, and heart failure medications will be as per usual guidelines. And all patients who are on oral anticoagulants who are giving antiplatelets, a proton pump inhibitor is indicated unless there is any contraindication to it to prevent GI bleeding. Then the critical question coming to any treating physician of such a patient is there a place for a coronary intervention in this patient? My answer for that is this, the first principle: treat the more life-threatening entity more aggressively than the other. So if the acute coronary syndrome is the more life-threatening entity, there's a definite place for a intervention. Let's see what the guidelines say. This is ESC guidelines for management of non-ST elevation myocardial infarctions 2020. It clearly says that an early invasive coronary angiogram should be considered in high bleeding risk patients, irrespective of oral anticoagulant exposure, to expedite treatment allocation, medical versus PCI versus CABG, and to determine the optimal antithrombotic regime. Class 2A recommendation with a level of evidence of C. So it's recommended in guidelines. This chart demonstrates the without high bleeding risk in usual patients with non-ST elevation MIs, how you triage to take to cath lab. This the very high risk patients on the left hand corner. You see the dark red box, the very high risk patients who have hemodynamic instability, who are in cardiogenic shock, recurrent refractory chest pain, in spite of medical management, life-threatening arrhythmias, mechanical complications of MI, acute heart failure clearly related to the non-ST elevation MI, then patients who are having ST segment depression of more than 1 millimeter in more than 6 leads, plus ST segment elevation in AVR and V1. These patients are at very high risk, and anyway, angiogram is indicated within the first 2 hours. For the patients who are at high risk, that is established non-STEMI diagnosis, dynamic new or presumably new contiguous STT changes, resuscitated cardiac arrest without ST segment elevation, or grace risk who more than 140. These are at high risk. In these patients, non-STEM, the coronary angiogram and intervention is indicated within first 24 hours. And the others are fall into the low risk category. They can be selectively taken for coronary angiogram after stress test later. So independent of bleeding, this our patient, there was a definite indication for a invasive angiogram early. And the presence of bleeding further reinforces that indication, because we have to come to a anatomical diagnosis early to decide on revascularization as well as to optimum antithrombotic regime. So when doing the coronary angiogram in the cath lab, radial artery approach should be the default vascular access, because femoral artery approach is associated with more bleeding complications. And if the INR is more than 2.5, no periprocedural anticoagulants are required. Should not give heparin or enoxaparin during the procedure of the PCI. And glycoprotein 2B3A inhibitors are for only bailout from periprocedural complications, should not be used routinely. And if the INR is less than 2.5 on warfarin, or patients who are NOACs need low dose anticoagulation. So once coronary angiogram is done, prognosis and further management will depend on the coronary anatomy. If culprit lesion is favorable for PCI, you load with aspirin and clopidogrel if not already done. Choose the minimally complex technique to do the PCI. So you have to finish the procedure quickly without using with the least amount of anticoagulants. Use the minimum required number of stents and the shortest possible length of stents. Use if you can do without stents, if you can just balloon and come out with a reasonable result, that is the best. And you treat only the culprit lesion. You don't look for try for complete revascularization in these patients in this stage. And use third generation drug eluting stents, which has safety data for early termination of dual antiplatelet therapy. There are non-polymer drug eluting stents and certain drug eluting stents which have evidence for early termination of DAPT, those stents are preferred. However, if the culprit lesion is not favorable for PCI, which is frequently encountered in this kind of patients who go into cardiogenic shock with non-STEMIs, then you have to have a multidisciplinary meeting with the cardiac surgical team and decide. And they will obviously have a poor prognosis in this setting. Once the PCI is done, you have to select the appropriate antiplatelet regime for these patients. So having a very high bleeding risk, the appropriate regime would be dual antiplatelet therapy, aspirin and clopidogrel for 1 month and clopidogrel thereafter. If the bleeding risk is very high, you can stop the second antiplatelet agent, aspirin, in 1 week and clopidogrel thereafter. In this patient, due to the mitral valve mechanical processes, warfarin is also needed to be continued with an INR of about 3. In summary, we come back to the principles which I told earlier. Treat the more life-threatening entity more aggressively than the other. Avoid over-treating either. Take local measures to stop the bleed early, then aggressively correcting the coagulation defect whenever possible. Calculated correction of the specific clotting factor defect should be done, avoiding overcorrection. Guideline-based minimum antithrombotic regime should be used to manage the acute coronary syndrome. And early coronary angiography and PCI of the culprit vessel with the use of minimum essential antithrombotic treatment should be done whenever possible. Thank you.